I'm Geeta Ganapathy-Doré. I'm the current president of the Society for Activities and Research on the Indian World. Sorry for short.
Hello, I'm Ludmila Volná. I'm a lecturer in English at Charles University in Prague. I'm one of vice presidents of the Society for Activities and Research on the Indian World and the non-India membership representative at IACLAUS Delhi.
Welcome to the special issue on Reinventing the Sea. Most of the papers collected in this issue were first presented at the SARI conference on Reinventing the Sea, Precarity, Epistemology and Narratives, held in June 2017 with the support of Sorbonne Paris-Nord University and Paris-Nanterre University. The sea remains a symbol of what is vast, deep, mysterious, and dangerous. It appears in our collective songs, myths, literature, and art. Global economy and trade rely on maritime routes and networks for keeping goods and ideas in circulation.
The conference was based on the premise that the sea is being reinvented everywhere as a means to resist and survive, as a strategic frontier to be redesigned, but also as home.
We think that a good introduction to the different and complex issues examined in this particular issue of Angles would be Derek Walcott's poem, The Sea is History.
The sea is history. Where are your monuments, your battles, martyrs? Where is your tribal memory? Sirs, in that gray vault, the sea has locked them up. The sea is history.
This issue has articles from authors, first who deal with sea as history, second from authors who explore the sea as a metaphor in literature, studying the impact on language and culture of sea crossings, especially during colonial times, and third, from authors who take up post-colonial texts dealing with environmental crises and climate change and discuss the resulting phenomena of migration and neglect of human rights.
Start with facts and history. Oceans cover 71% of the Earth's surface and contain 97% of the Earth's water. The Chevalier de Jaucourt, who wrote the entry on ocean for Diderot and D'Alembert's Encyclopédie in the 18th century, observed that dividing the ocean into seas was a cognitive strategy to come to grips with the unknown. One way to reinvent the ocean, as Philip Steinberg points out, is not to consider it as a space outside human beings who settle inside, that is, on the land, but look upon it as a mobile and dynamic space that is central to the flows of modern society.
Even before the Renaissance, when the center of the world shifted to Europe, Greek and Roman travelers of the ancient world had known India and Sri Lanka. But unlike their Renaissance counterparts, ancients had no maps. In the first article of this issue, Jean-Marie Kowalski argues that their knowledge and representations of the maritime spaces of India and Sri Lanka were odological, that is, thinking about space in linear terms, like, for example, lists of towns along the coasts, rather than cartographical. In the 21st century, the world is slowly moving away from the Mercator projection, where the developed global north appears bigger than reality, and moving towards adopting the Peters projection, which shows the relative size of different countries in a more accurate manner. In the same way, while the azimuthal polar projection depicted on the 1945 UN flag places the North Pole at the center, in the postcolonial era, attempts are made to represent the world with the South at the top or centered on the Pacific rather than the Atlantic.
These changes highlight the importance of areas such as the Indian Ocean, which is often overlooked as a key area in history. Ingrid Sankey invites history and geography teachers to treat the Indian Ocean world as a zone of dynamic interaction between peoples to enable the students to learn about past histories and present territories in a refreshingly south-up perspective.
Joëlle Wicks's article returns to the colonial past and the island of sands, now called Tromelin Island, in the Indian Ocean, where 80 Malagasy slaves were abandoned by a ship belonging to the French East India Company in 1761. It took 15 years for First Officer Tromelin to rescue the surviving 7 women and lone child. Joëlle Wicks's article about this minor episode on the margins of the empire highlights a place of memory not only for the forgotten slaves, but also for slavery as a traumatic event of human history. Her contribution sheds light on a particularly harrowing episode of the slave trade, which has received too little attention from history books.
Literature has also contributed to discussing the importance and reinventions of the sea. Ludmila Volná proposes an original reading of Salman Rushdie's meta-narrative story on storytelling, written in the form of a children's book, Haroun and the Sea of Stories. Ludmila Volná explores the depths of the sea metaphor with the help of Hindu mythology. For Hindus, the sea represents the dream world of Maya. The story's villain creates a totalitarian system that silences storytellers.
Ahmed, Mulla turns to Amitav Ghosh's novel Sea of Poppies, which recounts the story of Indian indentured laborers who replaced African slaves in British plantation colonies. The Indians believed that crossing of black waters, Kalapani, imperiled their selves and their culture. The process of social, cultural and linguistic creolization of the migrant Indian laborers started in the heterotopic space of the ship.
Maria-Sabina, Draga, Alexandru also studied texts by Amitav Ghosh. One a novel, The Hungry Tide, and the other an essay, The Great Derangement, on climate change. If colonialism functioned on the basis of an assumption of European superiority over non-European civilizations, non-European forms of knowledge now seem to prevail over Western knowledge.
Ghosh's interest in climate change and the destruction caused by man can also be compared with natural catastrophes, such as the Boxing Day tsunami in 2004. In her contribution, Gita Ganapathy-Doré studies 3 different narratives written by women authors that depict this cataclysmic moment in Sri Lanka. Whether it is an intensely personal trauma narrative or a humanitarian narrative of suffering told from the outsider's point of view, or a narrative of mourning that purports to denounce the violation of human rights, the narratives she studies from and about Sri Lanka have a ripple effect on England and old hierarchies of power. They testify to the shift from the psychological to the ecological orientation of reality in the contemporary world of precarious lives.
The last contribution to this issue completes the sea-centered perspective of this issue. If we began this introduction by quoting a poem by Derek Walcott, we will conclude with Malathi Mathu's article on poetry written about the Pacific. Mathu discusses Alec Derwent Hope's Man Friday and Christopher Brennan's Each Day I See the Long Ships Coming into Port. Hope's reframing of Daniel Defoe's famous novel Robinson Crusoe gives voice to the silent slave and pictures the sea as both a dividing barrier leading to exile and a welcoming bosom into the embrace of which to return is to go home. In Christopher Brennan's poem, on the contrary, Mather argues that the ship carrying the narrator symbolizes prophecy, anticipation, and reaching out to other cultures. Brennan chooses to record the shaping of Australia by the migrant's experience.
Malathi Mathu is a poet herself, and we would like to repeat her concluding words to end this introduction on reinventing the sea. The sea can never be possessed. It can only possess, and possess absolutely. We hope you enjoy the articles. Thank you.